Assad also believed that such a peace would strengthen the Arab world. But Kissinger thought that strengthening the Arabs would destabilize his balance of power. So he set out to do the very opposite, to fracture the power of the Arab countries by dividing them and breaking their alliances so they would keep each other in check. Kissinger now played a double game, or as he termed it, constructive ambiguity. In a series of meetings, he persuaded Egypt to sign a separate agreement with Israel. But at the same time, he led Assad to believe that he was working for a wider peace agreement, one that would include the Palestinians. In reality, the Palestinians were ignored. They were irrelevant to the structural balance of the global system.
The hallmark of Kissinger's thinking about international politics is its structural design. Everything is always connected in his mind to everything else. But his first thoughts are on that level, on the structural global balance of power level. And as he addresses questions of human dignity, human survival, human freedom, I think they tend to come into his mind as an adjunct of the play of nations at the power game.
When Assad found out the truth, it was too late. In a series of confrontations with Kissinger in Damascus, Assad raged about this treachery. He told Kissinger that what he had done would release demons hidden under the surface of the Arab world. Kissinger described their meetings. Assad's controlled fury, he wrote, was all the more impressive for its eerily cold, seemingly unemotional demeanor. Assad now retreated. He started to build a giant palace that loomed over Damascus. And his belief that it would be possible to transform the Arab world began to fade. A British journalist who knew Assad wrote, "Assad's optimism has gone. A trust in the future has gone. What has emerged instead is a brutal, vengeful Assad who believes in nothing except revenge."
Welcome to the Michael Brooks Show. I'm Michael Brooks. Left is best, ladies and gentlemen, comrades, friends and enemies. With me, as always, super producer Matt Leck.
Hello.
Head theoretician David Grisham.
How's it going?
Still finding, found it. White Barry White. And of course, super producer David Slavik, roaming the digitosphere, monitoring the Discord, and checking out the whole TMBS connected universe. I basically make him sound like our little mini Stasi or something. But it's all benign. On this week's program, we're talking with Benjamin Dixon about the left, Syria, charting the right course on foreign policy, what Democrats need to do to not only win, but finally, can they actually deliver the social movements, the pressure points, the context that's needed, and the strategy necessary. Then Brendan Sutton, pretty bad lefty, host of the Discourse, he's with us in studio, and we are first dunking on an android that I thought we did not have to make fun of anymore. And then she was hired by the Washington Post because I don't know if it's failing up in this society, but a sort of like boring sociopathing up Megan McArdle, obviously.
And crueling up.
Right.
I don't know if crueling is a verb, but let's make it one, guys.
Yeah, crueling up. Then, speaking of crueling up, a very hyperactive little twerp's name was searched often by a terrorist. We're going to get to why.
Facts don't care about your feelings.
facts don't care about your feelings. You're about to enter a no-fact zone. This is TMBS. But first, let's start with a little bit of a preset on Syria, the left, and how to look at the world. Now, obviously, that's very ambitious, and I want to just sort of put a couple of pieces of the puzzle together, because I think how we think about Syria, now how we analyze it, the variables that we put together and put in place are very important for the left having a coherent view of power, of solidarity, and just, look, let's be real, the complexity necessary to deal with the world as it is, as well as we would want it to be, and not what we might fantasize it to be. And I'll explain what that means in a moment. First, let's start with the basic ground reality of Syria. The uprising against the Bashar al-Assad regime was not one of, you know, CIA engineering. It was not a foreign plot to destabilize a government which presided over a nationalist regime of happy Syrians. Tensions in the Syrian regime go back to the 1980s, including incredibly brutal put-downs of uprisings by Assad's father. This is a Arab nationalist regime that definitely tended towards a very narrow form of authoritarianism, and actually under Bashar al-Assad, neoliberal reforms, which was another major reason for the initial uprising. Climate change, depreciating economic opportunities, as well as general corruption and repression, set that context. Assad responded militarily. The movement was brutally cracked down upon, and then the CIA, the Gulf states, did what they do. They funded far-right Sunni groups. ISIS arose. Jabhat al-Nusra was there. Brutalities broke out on all sides, although they're all objective standard accounts would say that the Assad regime is responsible for most deaths, which is not to say that, of course, the Sunni Syrian opposition groups are not responsible for many themselves. Let's just play a little bit of B-roll here. This is footage from Afghanistan in the 1980s of Mujahideen fighters. You can watch this if you're watching this on YouTube. These are the types of people that were favored by U.S. foreign policy and certainly Gulf foreign policy. The irony of no one has funded and been more happy to utilize far-right Sunni groups than makers of U.S. foreign policy from particularly the CIA in places ranging from Afghanistan to Pakistan to now Syria. Those are all of the realities in play. Russia and Iran are literally on the ground as outside forces propping up the Assad government, the Assad regime. Turkey, a NATO ally, has invaded Kurdish territories, the Kurds being the only left force, not perfect, but only left force, and the one that actually defeated ISIS along with support of U.S. Air support and logistics. There's no question about that. That's the reality we're in. And I want to say a couple of things before we get to some of the broader international dimensions of this. Chemical weapons have been used. My going back to the agreement on the Red Line, which was negotiated by Russia and halted a bombing campaign in 2014, that basically the Russians agreed to contain the chemical weapon of the Assad government at that time, which sounds like a pretty implicit acknowledgement that they had that chemical weapon capacity. So I think that certainly at least some of these attacks, and most international observers think that these were done by the Assad regime. But I want to make a broader point here. It's time to stop fetishizing who did these attacks one way or another and looking for narrow legalisms one way or another. And I'll explain. Look, we should not be bombing Syria. You should never support a single military operation undertaken by Donald Trump. Under Obama and under Trump, U.S. air deployments against ISIS, first and foremost, have killed many Syrian and Iraqi civilians. That is the core story. If it emerges and it's unequivocal, and if evidence can ever convince you that Assad did it, would you change your view? Probably not. I happen to have the view that he probably did do all of these attacks, and I still oppose the intervention. We need to look at the broader context. Now, in this context, the way this civil war has gone, if I was a member of Alawite or Druze or Shia in Iraq or Christian or in Syria, rather, it would make a lot of sense to me that while I would have no doubt, it cannot be minimized for a second, that Assad is a butcher and presides over an incredibly horrific system, that those groups that have gradually taken over the opposition and which still receive backing from us are, in some cases, and certainly in ISIS case, almost like Khmer Rouge-like in their politics, and would implement all sorts of religious and ethnic cleansing. These are all of the factors that we have to take in play. And my problem with a lot of the discourse that has emerged on the left is that first, there's a sense of minimizing the reality of Assad in order to justify opposing action. We don't need to minimize the reality of Assad, his monstrosity and his body count, in order to oppose military action. And we can also acknowledge that, as an example, Hezbollah has protected minorities and liberated minorities in certain areas. And it's also killed civilians. These things are all true. This isn't some fairy tale. This is a complicated, brutal, unending situation. And it's about to shift. And at this point, in fact, mostly these Sunni extremist forces are on retreat. What does that mean next? Certainly civilians under their control have been abused by them, but also airily bombarded by Assad and the Russians. So there's a broader reality here and a broader humanitarian terror. It is shifting in Iran and Russian and Assadist favor. And we can be honest about it and realize how this is all played out and what we should or shouldn't do without making up some narrative to justify one path or another. Conversely, if we pull out of those Kurdish territories and we allow the Turks to go in and clean it up, there will be mass ethnic cleansing of Kurds and the destruction of a very important political settlement there, a political progress and political experiment. On the international level, I'm going to play a brief report, a moment first, of how this is spilling over into international institutions and some of the concerns of the broader crisis that could come out of this are actually being mouthed here. This is a report from the show Mike Hanna at the United Nations, and you're going to hear from Secretary General Antonio Guterres.
Time the counselors met on Syria this week, a series of meetings that have served only to illustrate the massive divide on the issue. The Secretary General's repeated calls for unity ignored.
They urge all members to show restraint in these dangerous circumstances and to avoid any acts that could escalate matters and worsening the suffering of the Syrian people.
So that's the truth. And I want to get here, too, to a possible alternative which had its own pitfalls. This is an interview. Actually, again, we're relying heavily. I got to interview Mike soon. I must be missing him. This is an interview that Mike Hanna conducted with former South African President Thabo Mbeki in 2013, where he talked about his approach to dealing with Robert Mugabe in Zimbabwe diplomatically, the lessons he learned in negotiating a transition from apartheid in South Africa, and applied them to the situation in Syria. This is back in 2013.
But as I said, you get this view, which is not only African. You see it now manifesting itself with regard to Syria. Fortunately, it's now agreed, let's have a Geneva II. But it's quite clear that some of these Western countries have been pursuing a view to say that wrong things in Syria, yes, indeed, were wrong things in Syria. If Syria needs democratization, yes, indeed, it does. And all of you must attend to these challenges, yes, it's true. But then some people say in order to get there, remove Assad. Fortunately, I'm saying now, people are saying Geneva too, no. Let all the Syrians get together. will assist them to get to a solution which sorts out the Syrian thing. It's no different from the position we took with the Gaddu's map. It is indeed no different from the position we took with regard to the solution of the South African question. See, our own insistence, we were in exile, but said these negotiations, we better have them inside South Africa.
So that's a really interesting lesson there. Thabo Mbeki's record on Zimbabwe was very mixed, to say the least, though he did negotiate some power-sharing agreements, but he also covered for Robert Mugabe's theft of elections and rampant abuses. But the broader point there, and the fact that he brilliantly brings in South Africa, later in the same interview, he talks about negotiations in Sudan with Bashar, the president of Sudan, wanted by the International Criminal Court, but actually being necessary for undertaking a diplomatic process. And so Thabo was saying, look, of course you could have indicted apartheid leaders by any measure of international law. They were murderers. They were oppressors. But I needed them. I needed to sit and negotiate a transition with them. And I think the point of that is important, because that perspective can allow us to do two things. One, look for points of solidarity where we can find them. In Syria, it's undoubtedly, first of all, with people of every single background there that are suffering under a multi-pronged imperial intervention and imperial proxy war from the United States and the Saudis to the Iranians to the Russians to the Turks. Massive human suffering. Then the Kurds, who have created a worthwhile and important political project and have defeated ISIS. And three, the initial process in the beginning of recognizing that you don't need to build a romantic fantasy about a figure like Assad, but you do, on the other hand, cannot be one of these Western interventionists, and you have to think structurally. What does an Assad regime protect? Who are the religious minorities who, even if they're repressed and abused by it, know that they could be genocided if he's gone? And why is it that somebody like Mbeki is able to see very early in this process that the demand he go is the negation of the process that could potentially even some things out and improve conditions, and is where, in fact, after they have won this horrific war, which is what is about to happen, what you'd hope for. This is what somebody like Patrick Coburn is calling for. Assad's going to stay president, but he needs to release political prisoners. Okay, I think that's extremely unlikely. In fact, I will imagine more vengeance and killing and repression from this regime. But if we can both hold the fact that there are almost no good actors in these situations, we don't need to build an alternative narrative to oppose war and U.S. imperialism. We should oppose all imperialism. Look for points of worthwhile solidarity and concrete support and connection points, which is what we should be looking for in every single political situation in the globe. And then number three, listen to voices who have actually dealt with complicated negotiations and know the various sort of interests and networks that actually make politics happen everywhere across the globe, which U.S. policymakers, even in a cynical sense, have failed again and again and again and again. That's a framework for how we can at least discuss these things intelligently. Okay, we got to get to the shout out. And the shout out is to myself for a really smart Syria commentary. No, New Zealand, although no, it was pretty good. A lot of people are saying it on the Discord. Actually, probably some people aren't saying it on the Discord. Matt, the reason I'm vamping is, do we have the shout out music? Like that. It's like Matt's just like, oh, he's just in a good riff. Just going to get back to swipe right. Nope. And that's a left. That's a right. New Zealand has announced a ban on new permits for offshore oil exploration. exploration as it attempts to move towards a low-carbon future. Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern said it would help protect future generations from climate change. The move would not affect 22 existing permits, so this is reformist, not radical, but it would start a transition to banning all offshore drilling in New Zealand. It's reformist, but it's a concrete move, and it's a victory we should take in really one of the ultimate defining structural crises of our time. That's, you know, it's very funny because so many people across the political spectrum, they talk about things like the economy as if they are set in stone, whereas these things are literally all made up. I'm sorry, but they are a social contract, man. They are constructed. Oxygen isn't constructed. You know, species are not negotiated by regulatory frameworks and philosophy books. These are actual things that we are actually destroying at an awe-inspiring rate. And we need to take just every type of action urgently. And this is some of that. So we should acknowledge it in the shout out. All right. Let's get to the reasons why you guys should join over. Do you have that music ready, Matt? It's all right. You know, just take your time. We don't need to. Time's just a construct too, man. Fucking it. Whoa, no. Fuck.
That's what happens if you let Birdman Shout Out play a bit too long.
DJ Danarchy, I would like a shout out that is ours. I'm such a hypocrite. I listen to music like that all the time. That's for you, not for me. I'll listen to anything. If it's not problematic, I'm not listening. Unless it's Chronix. My reggae stuff is not as problematic. Guys, we are growing. Had a little bit, touch of drop for taxes. So if you haven't yet and you can, it's time. And there's a new offering for people at 21 and above levels, which we're going to be announcing very soon, including the people who just joined at that level that have made a very wise decision in addition to the monthly organizing and conference calls with me. When we get to 2K, which we are actually not terribly far away from, we have another several hundred to go, but we're moving pretty fast. There's going to be many more regular animations. We're working on Right Wing Mandela. That's what's going to be next. The Food Bucket Challenge, which is going to be horrifying. I'm already predicting that. I'm going to tap out immediately.
It sounds disgusting.
Yeah, but you're going to win. I'm going to be like in the corner, like drinking chamomile tea,
yeah, I'm much
soothing
less
my stomach.
Yeah, I can put whatever in there.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Krishkam's the dark horse. I'm going to be like, this doesn't agree with me. I need to ayurvedically cleanse myself.
Like, Michael's going to be washing every bite down with like some special tea.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I did set preconditions for the contest that supplement, like the equivalent of doping is allowed. I appreciate all of you. We're growing fast. And when we start hitting those next cycles of numbers, we're going to be expanding content a little bit. We're going to be having our own YouTube channel coming out soon, so that this stuff is clickable and shareable. If you aren't a patron, you're missing not only incredibly good, I mean, really a parallel entertaining, accessible and engaging political education on everything from the Middle East to the Caribbean to the political philosophers that have shaped our time to deep dives with people like Ronnie Casserolls, who are revolutionaries, political leaders, journalists. It's equipping our community and arming them to deeply contribute to political life. And we're proud of it. We're moving. I appreciate everybody. Appreciate everybody on the team. I appreciate all patrons. It's time to join. Patreon.com/TMBS. Patreon.com/TMBS. Dipset. I'll be right back with Benjamin Dixon. Welcome back to the Michael Brooks Show. Joining us now is Benjamin Dixon. He's the host of the Benjamin Dixon Show. Like me, he's a very astute namer of things. He's also the founder of the Progressive Army. Benjamin, how are you doing?
Hey, Mike. Thanks so much for having me, man. I'm doing pretty good. All things considered, it being tax day and all.
Tax day is not fun. I really wish that my small business involved selling arms to conflict zones and hiding it in Bermuda, and then I could benefit from the latest tax shenanigans.
Yeah, it's like we're in that zone where you don't really make enough to be able to get away without paying taxes. So right. Yes, it's that real tight space where you make just enough to owe the government a lot
right.
of money.
Yeah, you're right in that zone where you're productive enough to pay, but you're actually like doing work and you haven't inherited a bunch of money. Whoa.
Exactly.
You are going to get so screwed. Yeah. It is the middle class has a point on taxes. No doubt about it.
Yeah.
Has every kind of point imaginable. And by the way, let me just also throw this out there. This whole like, you should be proud of supporting this, like play your role. That is the most toxic garbage talking point propagated by like, you know, people who might like pay like the equivalent of like $10 of their net assets in taxes while they might hit you with 45% of your income. Don't ever say that again. It's a loser line.
Being proud to pay your part.
Don't be proud to pay your part. If you're not making, if you're not a multimillionaire, you shouldn't really be paying anything.
Take every deduction.
Yeah. Take every single.
Well, I won't say how many I took. So
yeah, I was going to say let's be careful here.
Let's talk about Syria.
Do you remember there was a guy on Howard Stern show years ago who like literally mapped out like, and it wasn't deductions; it was just like fraud. And he got like arrested the next day. It's pretty funny. Just like, I don't pay shit.
Some people are too dumb to be as rich as they are. But
I know.
There's no correlation between intelligence and wealth. So,
that's a conversation we're going to need to have for another day. So you know, Syria. I mean, I know you were watching that, and the reason I want to frame it around that commentary is I just think it's very important. And my opening gamut to you is, in opposing this action, which I think you and I see this pretty similarly, and even having a much broader systemic critique of U.S. empire and recognizing that empire is inseparable from inequality, capitalism, all the rest of it. You can't have one without the other. You can't have a domestic but not outward discourse. But at the same time, I think it's very important that you don't need to build up a parallel counter narrative of fantasy, which I'm afraid some people have done.
Yeah, no. So first of all, it was a great opening monologue on Syria. Very informative. And I think rich. And I encourage a lot of people. I'm going to encourage my audience to tune into that because you really break it down. In a way that should be clear, but the problem is what you're alluding to is that I don't think the left is seeing this through a clear set of lenses, right? We're creating this fantasy, and it's an intentional. It's like they can't handle the cognitive dissonance, or they can't handle the complex nature of this conflict in Syria to actually just admit that there's really, for lack of a better phrase, it's a clusterfuck that's happening in Syria right now. And it's a clusterfuck of not only of American imperialism, but also of Assad's own doing. Yep. And also other imperialist forces such as Russia. And then, of course, you know, then you get to the argument of which is the greatest empire, which was the greatest threat. So there's a lot of people who can't handle this situation analytically in Syria without crafting a lane where they can excuse away Assad's his war crimes, his own personal war crimes, because if they do that, then they feel there's some type of inherent need or they would be inherently supporting the United States in this. And I'm like, this is really one of those situations where it's all of the above, and you have to include Assad in that.
I guess, so we see 100% eye to eye. And so maybe the deeper question, and it's funny because I do think in online discourse right now, And I'm not drawing a false equivalency. Look, if you're going to be, you know, simplistic analysis that is left is certainly better than right-wing analysis or neoliberal analysis that is simplistic. But I want to make a broader, with that stipulated, I want to make a broader structural point. There is a lot of discourses are set up right now where people can just kind of choose their own adventure. Like, well, I'm a Hillary stan. Or, you know, Hunter Mott said a great line. He's like, well, you know, it's funny, like the whole Rogan, that whole crowd, it's like, they're brocially correct, right? Like they've got their own things that you can't question and you can't debate, their own personalities that are sacred.
Yeah.
I happen to think it's a double problem because I actually ultimately think that the left, I don't overvalue intellectuals, to be honest with you, but the left needs to be more analytically sound because our heels are on the back foot in so many situations. So we can't be idiots like these other people. But you get what I'm saying? Like, I feel like it points to a broader lack of, like, you got to think. And thinking means you hold contradiction.
Yes. Say that again. Thinking means that you can hold and actually enjoy holding contradiction so that you could try to find some resolution if there is any.
Right.
And I've just come to the conclusion that in this entire contradiction that is the Syrian civil war, there is no resolution here. Right. We almost have to just sit back and watch the monsters fight themselves. But to that end, to address your point, I think there is room for non-thinking people on the left. And I'm going to get in a lot of trouble for this, but whatever. I mean, it is what it is, because I'm thinking about this. There are a lot of people who have taken up the mantle and the war cry of being, well, that was oxymoronic, of being anti-war. Right. And it becomes a cliche, and it becomes something that they jump on Twitter to tweet about when they're not doing anything structurally to actually bring about an end or a resolution to war. So it becomes almost like demagoguery, or becomes a religion in a sense, where they can go and they can just whatever they need to justify in their minds to oppose American imperialism, because that's the extent of their critique. If you and I'm going to go a lot of places here, man, because this is a broad
go everywhere
subject for me.
Go.
If your critique of war ends with American imperialism, then you're not really doing anything to end war, because war existed, pre-existed, and it will exist after America's empire. So a lot of people, they get this analysis and they end it at American imperialism. And if your analysis ends there, then it totally makes sense for you to make this fantasy of Assad being some type of hero or some type of victim of American aggression, when in fact he is the monster of his own creation.
I think that that's exactly right. And the reason it concerns me is because I think that we, you know, because it's funny because, and you could see my own contradictions and tensions in my, you know, opening commentary. Because on one hand, what I really want to say to people is, especially, look, if you're in government, you have a completely different set of decisions to make. And I actually think from a policy point of view, you know, I mean, I'll just say, I mean, you had the lane there. I mean, I Thabo and Becky, I think from the policy governing perspective with regards to Syria, he's nailed it. He's 100% right. They should have seen if there was any possible way to create some type of diplomatic process there. Now, you know, I mean, people have to remember, like, you know, I remember a story from the beginning of the uprising, and I actually think this is one of the reasons that this pisses me off so much that this part of it is dismissed. And I recognize what's happened with the opposition and everything else. But, there was, some young men were basically abducted who were doing protests of the local, government offices. These women came, they did a silent protest, and they held their sons' keffiyehs, being like, they're missing. And a local police guy or military guy came out and he said, if you want more sons, come in here and I'll give you new ones. Like, wow. I'll rape you in prison. I mean, people need to be real about what they're talking about. So I want to stipulate that. But the other two things that I'm kind of pointing to is, like, okay, the Thabo version is analytically and from a policy perspective makes total sense. But there's disturbing implications from that for a certain type of, you know, anti-imperial Twitter lefty. Because if we're going to say that politics requires a lot of negating moral principles and dealing with people with blood in their hands, well, then that means that, you know, Israeli leaders are different. Ehud Olmert's different than Benjamin Netanyahu. They both have blood in their hands. They both ran an apartheid state. But they're totally different in terms of the type of diplomacy they're willing to have with Palestinians. So
Brooks,
you need to either follow the implication or step out of it.
Exactly. You either have to go with this, what you're arguing for in Syria, or what may end up being the best solution in Syria. If you can't follow that through logically to the logical conclusion and the implications, what that means for your argument as a pacifist leftist, and then even what does it mean for your critique of the United States? Right. You know, what does it mean for your critique of the type of dictators that the United States has dealt with before? See, we won't always be able to craft beautiful narratives of victimhood for murderous dictators so that we can justify our anti-American our anti-American imperialism critique and worldview. When in some cases you're going to be confronted with the reality that there is a brutal dictator in power. And the only way that we can proceed forward with a modicum of peace is if we actually negotiate with this man through diplomacy and allow him to remain in power, right? And so without having that in your framework and in your thinking, then you're not really doing yourself, or you're doing the anti-war left a disservice, because we haven't thought it all the way through. I mean, what about America's previous relationships with dictators? If we're going to do this in Syria, or even better yet, let me get off of that. Let me go to another point. Here's my other point. In Syria, if your justification for Assad remaining in power is to not have any external power influencing their domestic politics, then what do you say about other nations that are legitimate, that you even yourself believe are oppressed by imperialist powers? I mean, there are so many things that are not thought through.
Well, and also, and what do you say about literally? I mean, look, Russia and Iran are literally on the ground. And I understand the narrow technical point that they are invited by the Assad regime. But I also thought that we all wanted to pull out of Afghanistan. Well, guess who's invited U.S. troops to be in Afghanistan? The Afghan government. So my point, and I want to run two, I agree with you on that completely, and I want to run two other stipulations by you. So first is that if you want to have a realist argument that deals in the world that someone like Thabo Mbeki, who's a, you know, very sophisticated, and I mean, I thought his Zimbabwe policy was actually in a lot of ways a failure, but I mean, somebody who, you know, looks at things in a very analytic and diplomatic and not necessarily, you know, a clinical fashion in some respects, including his own situation. That's how he was he was able to negotiate with people that literally murdered his comrades, okay? So, okay, if that's it, then you need to realize that you're coming from a more realist and diplomatic position, and you shouldn't make the same kind of appeals to human rights. You should be looking at what is the most rational, what's the most, and that might lead you to a lot of unsavory, smart calculations.
Well, just to be sure now.
Well, let me just add the two other.
For your audience. Let me just drop this right here.
Yeah.
Because you're talking about realism from the international relations perspective, and if they're going to embrace that, they actually become in league with their most hated villain, which is Henry Kissinger. So,
That's what I wanted to kind of get to the other two points. My point is, and I think there's variations like Thabo Mbeki, I'm trying to use a positive example. You know, he's not Henry Kissinger, right? So you're in that universe of thinking more critically about policy without being a total monster like Henry Kissinger. But then let's take two other examples. So, okay, take it out of Syria. Venezuela, I haven't covered it enough because honestly, I feel like I just haven't really made a clear call on it. And I could say 100%, obviously, the Venezuelan government is nothing. I mean, comparing it to Assad is insane. It's a radically different thing. But, you know, Maduro's messing up and there's a lot of failures. Now, my first and foremost thing, though, from the perspective of being a U.S. citizen, is stop. Stop interfering. Stop. The CIA is there. We're supporting right-wing actors. So in some respects, that's where your point comes in, which I agree. Like, I can have a million different factors of analysis, and I don't need to make up a story about Maduro being great. But I just know, first and foremost, my obligation is my government should stop acting imperially and colonially in Venezuela, period. Okay. Yeah. And then number three, find your points of allyship. And that's why the Kurds matter. Because the Kurds are the only faction there that, and they're not perfect, and you shouldn't go in the over other direction and over-romanticize them, but they have, you know, they're experimenting with direct democracy. They defeated ISIS. They've had, you know, improvements on women's rights, ecology. They're hosting, you know, refugees from other parts of the country. And every other faction has either engaged in just rampant indiscriminate violence or has a objectively colonial or imperial interest. So my third thing would be to say is find your connection point.
Yeah. No, I mean, if we just start with the Kurds, I absolutely agree with you. And that presents a very complicated problem, particularly with Turkey going in and invading those territories. I mean, that presents a problem with the United States.
Well, it's a disaster.
I'm not sure how that plays itself out. But to your other points, I mean, there is a logical conclusion that I think the anti-war left has not allowed their analysis to go to. And it's because it requires so many contradictions to be held at the same time. And it requires us to even look at ourselves in the mirror and to say, you know, to ask ourselves, how do we resolve this with our own personal moral beliefs? You know, if we believe in human rights, then how can we tolerate being in a situation where we have to accept a murderous dictator? And I think the easy way out has been to say, no, these aren't murderous dictators. This is really just the CIA. If we just get rid of American imperialism, then we have no more problems. And to me, that is a betrayal of the true anti-war left, because we need real solutions and we need real institutions to be built so that when policies are being presented to the president, we need an anti-war left in a position to actually put a policy on the table as an option. If we don't ever get to that point, then we really are just treating this like a religion. And you know, we have our high holy days where we get out there and we decry war, but not really doing anything to end it.
Yeah, and get structural. You know, you want to deal with the CIA, you want to deal... I mean, look, you know, we run... Why are we so obsequious with MBS and letting him run Saudi Arabia and this whole scam, even while he's, you know, murdering, and we're fueling their shipments for this indiscriminate slaughter in Yemen, which the United States and Britain are directly involved with every single day? Well, part of it is actually really crude and simple lefty stuff. There's a huge amount of money to be made in selling arms to the Saudi government. So, you know, even on that level, you can get... I guess what I'm just trying to say is there's multiple angles, and I know you're saying this too, that like you can engage and you can intervene on everything from U.S. imperialism to the arms industry to even smart calls for, no, don't just come out and say Assad needs to go. What are the factors there? Who are the people on the ground? How does this work? What does someone like Thabo Mbeki say? It was a much more sophisticated understanding of these things than some idiot on TV here. But none of those things require a fantasy built up about a trust fund baby mass murderer inherited dictatorship being an anti-imperialist lion.
I'm laughing because as you put it like that, I mean, Assad literally is everything that the left should hate.
Yes.
In every sense of the word.
Yes.
But because he's, you know, somehow he's being rewritten as the anti-American imperialist. And that's just a convenient way to not have to deal with some real contradictions that will make us look at ourselves and really. I mean, Syria is the perfect case study. I mean, if we take away all the atrocities, and we take away all of the families that are murdered and bloodshed, and I mean, 500,000 people killed up at this to this point. I mean, if you can manage to separate yourself from that and look at this from a case study perspective, it literally exposes every angle of this, from the left to the right, to the alt-right, to American imperialism, to other forms of imperialism. I mean, it is a chance for us to really look internally and find a way to go forward, because we have to, the critical analysis that's required for us to understand Syria, not to have a solution, because there is not, there's none, Let's get that straight. Yep. There is none. And none of us, and before I even finish that, none of us are advocating for any military action.
Not at all.
It's almost like it's so overly simplified. if you don't come out and say the standard anti-war lefty kind of sounding things, they automatically make you out to be an American imperialist who's advocating for regime change. And that is quite the opposite. We're saying that the situation is so complicated that there is no resolution. And the United States always messes things up when we attempt regime change. So the United States, regardless of Assad being a murderous dictator, in this case, hands off of Syria. But people can't really think on that level for some reason.
I think in these cases, you do need to have hands off for the right reasons, because it affects our analytic frameworks for dealing with, you know, because then it's like, well, what if actually Venezuela isn't a utopia? Now you support Mike Pompeo's plan to remove another Latin government and subvert another democracy in Latin America because of U.S. corporate interests? Of course not. But I don't need a fantasy about Maduro and that failure. And I can be in solidarity with people who might be suffering, and whether they support or oppose that government. I don't need, you don't need the fantasy and the inaccuracy to oppose the action. And that's life on planet Earth.
But that's shame on a lot of us commentators, man, particularly YouTube leftist commentators, is that we fall into those tropes, right?
Yeah.
And not you, not me, but almost damn near everybody else. They like to play up to those tropes because that's what the audience likes to hear. Nobody really wants to say the things that the audience doesn't want to hear, and because it costs you patrons, right? And
so I mean, I just, you know, example. I lost somebody recently over two people over Syria stuff recently. And, partially my thing to them is, I mean, look, it's terrifying because, you know, this is literally how we make our livings and stuff. And we are actually like small business people, which is ironic. But, you know, it's also like a question of like, supposedly what you're escaping when you get rid of your, you know, all of the corporate toxins and, you know, the propaganda of all of the out, you know, of Comcast and all of this, which are shills for arm manufacturers and do uncritically support U.S. militarism. I think the desire is you're getting with people that, you know, even if we're calling it wrong, I'm not going to lie to you or distort you or, you know, say something that I don't think because of a monetary incentive. And that really should be the whole fucking point of why we're all doing this.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. But, you know, you and I would, you know, not to pat ourselves on the back, but we are few and far and in between in this YouTube commentary of podcasting space. I mean, most people, I'm not even physically capable of just saying the thing that everybody wants to hear. You know what I mean? I couldn't even really tweet about the military action in Syria because I wanted to tweet about it in a nuanced way. But all around me, everyone was just giving their ye old usual demagoguery or, you know, whatever it was that people were saying, you know, calling it World War III. You know, YouTube commentators saying that this is World War III. And I'm like, I don't care about how many retweets you're getting on that kind of thing. Only in the sense that I'm really disappointed that more people aren't calling some of these really large platforms out for their bullshit.
Yeah, the last thing I'll say about that, what really bothers me about that is, again, it's like operationally, that's actually an area where, like, clearly the United States and Russia have actually been on some level attempting to coordinate so that there isn't some type of conflagration. So that's like the realist part. And then on the other hand, just earlier, we played in that Mike Hanna report. Antonio Gutierrez is like, there's a new Cold War and the whole international system is breaking down. And you know what? Like, that loses some of its urgency because this is a cliche that I've heard in a million, you know, silly like comments for years. And it's like, no, now it's actually a different thing. And the Secretary General saying it. And that's fucking concerning.
Brooks, I was just thinking about that today. If everyone is crying wolf with World War III and the conflict between the United States and Russia, when Donald Trump, somebody obviously let Russia know that this was happening. And you know what? I'm not mad at that.
No, that's great. That helps. That's a good thing. That's sanity. That's how it's supposed to work. Exactly. Of course.
Exactly. But you know, if everyone's crying wolf over World War III, we won't pay attention to the real subtle thing that could trigger it.
Yeah, no, I mean, the last thing was like what, you know, we're not going to open this whole can of worms, but it was funny. It was like the other example of this, and Sam actually said it the other day, it was like, well, you know, if your whole argument that we shouldn't have like an expanded conflict with Russia is that they didn't interfere in the election, well, what if they did? Well, I still support that we don't have expanded conflict with them. Like, that's a second order question. That's not the policy. That's not the baseline. Anyways, Dennis Kucinich. What are your thoughts?
I did a little clip on him last week.
Yeah.
You know, I really don't get excited about any politician anymore. But I do like the fact that how forward thinking he was. I don't know if you saw the clip of 2003 where John Stewart was mocking Dennis Kucinich for his support of LGBTQ rights.
Yep.
All the way to the point of being transphobic on his show, on the Daily Show.
Right.
And but there in the middle of it was Dennis Kucinich saying what most Americans are just getting around to, you know, what, 15 years later.
No doubt.
So from that perspective, I have a lot of respect for any person who can be that forward thinking when in reality, I probably was laughing at John Stewart's joke in 2003. Right. So we all need that type of leadership. So I'll keep an eye on him. I know for Ohio, of course, I mean, I think it should be all hands on deck to try to help him win that. But in terms of anything further beyond that, you know, we'll just have to see how the lay of the land.
Yeah, no, I think it's where, you know, I have critiques of Kucinich, but I actually think in some ways the bigger lesson here is that, you know, and even partially because of some traits about him that I'm, you know, not thrilled about, where he can get a little preachy or whatever, but I think, and a little flaky at times, but first of all, it's unbelievably hypocritical because, I mean, you know, everybody else's flakiness and nonsense is, you know, is written up as, you know, it's like, you know, they, and, you know, people know on this show, I'm, you know, agnostic and I don't have a kind of axe to grind about religion, but I will say, like, it is awe-inspiring to watch people make fun of, like, oh, look at Dennis Kucinich, he's such a new age freak. And then it's like, then these are other people that you're writing as serious candidates who say that the earth is flat. Like, what? Like, that's what are you talking about, right? Like, if, you know, it's either one way or another, guys. But
yeah.
I think that, you know, he's a good lesson of, like, the whole dismissal of him was that he's not serious and look at him and all of this. And this guy from Iraq to single payer to transgender rights to, you know, broader U.S. intervention. And even at times I might disagree with the methodology, but actually, no, a guy who really is like, basically, we should be oriented towards peace. I mean, and the climate and agriculture, like, he's right about all this stuff. And the whole dismissal with him was all just style and bullshit. And this guy has been right about all of it.
Yeah, well, I mean, this is America, right? The entertainment industry, both in the philosophical sense and in the economic sense, is all powerful and it controls everything. So, I mean, he does have to take that in consideration. I mean, he does come off a bit wacky.
Right.
And I would absolutely hate the fact that in America, not would, I do. Hate the fact that in America, everything that we just said that was so good about him can be all washed away because he just comes off as wacky.
You have broader thoughts. I mean, I think as we move into these, you know, midterms, I really feel like it's best of times, worst of times. I think that there's, you know, obviously a lot more grassroots activism. I had Lee Carter on this show a couple of weeks ago, and I think, you know, his win was amazing and he's totally on target. I know, I mean, we'll get into this some other time. I still think, you know, whatever, he's not perfect. And part of the problem is I think people shouldn't have fetishized him to begin with, but Bernie's great and he's doing it. You know, today he's calling for this new, you know, put pharma people in jail. He's listening, you know, he's said some very smart things on foreign policy. And then on the other hand, we still have, I mean, just this, if the Democrats were a brand, if Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi were handling, I mean, like maybe their Fila, like Fila was cool in the 80s. I mean, it's just, it doesn't win by its own terms because it's not like ruthless winner shit. And it's just, it's psychologically, politically, ideologically, and strategically exhausted.
Yeah, exhausting and depressing. I thought for sure you were going to say depressing because of their what they represent and their unwillingness to take on certain fights and their complicitness with other. I mean, it's just it's a mess. You know, in terms of a broader question of the midterms and coming up to 2020. Of course, Bernie is still cool in my book. Bernie still has a couple of lingering problems that he just has to resolve for the love of God. Like, understand the nuances of the black community and let's just move past it. Like, just get it. Hire the right consultants, because that's all Hillary Clinton did. She just hired the right consultants that made her look like she understood the black community when she absolutely didn't. So, Bernie, go out and hire some really, really good black consultants that help you.
Black. I was gonna say available, but all right, fine.
Yeah. No, well, I mean black. I mean, come on, man. Like, I know you are, but somebody's gonna take you seriously. But in terms of the other midterms, I mean, it is the best of times in the sense that I think there's going to be a wave that could break up the balance of power in D.C. And that's the best that we could hope for the next 2 years. The real question is what are the Democrats going to do in 2020? Because I think everyone is assuming that Trump is out in 4 years. But there's a good possibility that he could do an 8-year stint simply because the Democrats have never ceased to amaze me with their ability to lose.
Snatch defeat out of the jaws of victory, the Democratic Party. And then the last thing, and I want to see if you co-sign on this. I mean, I also think, like, you know, this conversation, which in some ways is great, you know, about focusing on different things, you know, street activism, local versus national, electoral versus not. I think that it's the thing that needs to start to crystallize is not only is there no contradiction, but that, and especially, because, I mean, if Democrats win in the midterms, I mean, that's necessary but not exciting is how I put it.
Right.
But if we start to get to a position where, like, a Jeremy Corbyn's in office or a Bernie Sanders, the work of saving them begins, like, the day after they're elected, because the forces of capital and reaction will, you know, and it's not about saving them as personalities, it's about implementing the agenda. So mobilizing on the street and mobilizing in elections, I just think are seamless at this point.
Yeah, well, actually, to go one step further, I think that work has to begin now. Matt Bruning and the People Policy Project, they have that going, that think tank for leftist economics. We need that kind of think tank for anti-war policies. We need actual structural institutions that could be there to support whoever gets elected, because without those institutions to support, you are going to have neoliberal and neoconservative institutions there to attack them. So we need to start that now.
Benjamin Dixon, one of the reasons I enjoy talking with you so much is because you are always right, by which I mean we pretty much agree on everything, which is obviously the sign of a brilliant mind. Benjamin Dixon.
I can't wait to see what we disagree about.
It's, you know, honestly, man, I have to say we've done enough of these things and even off, like, you know, off the books calls where it feels like it's going to be hard. It's going to need to be in music or something.
Absolutely.
All right, man. Benjamin Dixon, appreciate your time as always. Benjamin Dixon Show, Progressive Army. Actually, you'll catch me on Ben's show soon. Ben, thanks so much.
Take care.
All right, everybody. We are going to do I've gotten a lot of feedback that this should be the Gulag segment now instead of the pyramid. So we're going to do the little road test. Can I get the non-revisionist Grishkam version of... And we have that sound ready?
Oh, which sound?
The Ted Koppel thing.
Oh, yeah.
The music is ready? It's time to sentence someone to the gulag. It's sort of a sign of this guy's just robust stupidity and haplessness. And also that nobody who watches us is ever going to be like, hey, I just watched a great Sean Hannity clip. I think I'm going to become a Republican. Usually we try to target people that we might have some audience overlap with. But I have to say, watching somebody turn his whole media platform into like the most, this sort of synchronized, like unapologetic state fascistic style propaganda with a whiny sense of personal agreement for being called out on it is just astonishing. This is Sean Hannity with Ted Koppel. This is from last year. Check this out.
We have to give some credit to the American people that they're somewhat intelligent and that they know the difference between an opinion show and a news show.
Yeah.
You're cynical. Look at that. Yeah.
I am cynical because, you know.
You think we're bad for America? You think I'm bad for America?
Yeah.
You do?
In the long haul, I think you
really?
And all these opinion
That's
shows...
That's sad, Ted.
No, you know why?
That's sad.
Because
Talking
you're
over.
Very good at what you do, and because you have attracted a significantly
you
more
are
influential...
The American
well, let me
people
finish
short.
The sentence. Let me finish the sentence
I'm
before
listening.
You do that.
With all due respect.
You, yes.
Take
you have phone. You have attracted people who are... determined that ideology is more important than facts.
Okay, well, yeah. I mean, actually, ideology kind of is more important than facts in some ways, Ted. But I will say this. Yes, that was hilarious that Hannity kept interrupting literally the whole time.
You have the floor.
You have the floor. No, go ahead. Sure, please talk. Sorry. Yeah, no, you go ahead.
Go ahead, Michael.
Exactly. So... You know, and this guy goes out every single night. And when I first encountered Hannity, he was a, you know, belligerent moron robot for war and for Bush and every monstrosity that came out of that administration. And then he hated and whined and conspirized about Obama for 8 years. And now he's a Trump robot, unflinchingly. But the connection obviously got a little bit deeper this past week when it was revealed in court that Trump's lawyer, Michael Cohen, who apparently graduated from one of the worst law schools in America, was...
They don't write good. They don't know how to write good.
He doesn't know how to write good. In fact, some of his not being able to write good might be one of the reasons why Trump actually might for real be in trouble. Like, you know, like, hey, should I be taking notes on a potential fucking criminal enterprise during a legal meeting? Wait. Lawyer-attorney privilege doesn't count for fraud? Then what's the point? But it was revealed that Sean Hannity is Michael Cohen's, his third client. He only has three clients. And I don't know. I never noticed Sean Hannity. He's almost like just sort of like built into the background in a decaying late stage Roman Empire that is modern America. And as the water runs out and as we go through the sixth species extinction and as, you know, U.S. drones hover over Yemen and Somalia and melt people down and racism and patriarchy reassert themselves and Silicon Valley races to replace all of us with robots so we can live in best case scenario, some type of UBI technological American Foxconns. I just sort of take for granted that Sean Hannity was a piece of garbage who should have never risen above his proper station in life as an assistant baseball coach at a Roosevelt junior varsity baseball team. But there was something about that Michael Cohen thing and the fact that Michael Cohen was on there like practically like every week that just was like, even for you, you made Alan Dershowitz question your ethics. What the fuck does that say? Sean Hannity. And it would be great to sentence him to the gulag because he is one of these people who may actually believe that like a gulag is imminent if like Chrystia Gillibrand becomes president. So let me just say TMBS sentences Sean Hannity to the gulag and no Nerf football while he's there. You hack son of a bitch. Yeah, let's throw on some music. We'll take a brief break. You could do the same Dipset one or whatever's around. Doesn't matter. Push your teeth. All right, and then Brendan is here. Welcome back, Michael Brooks Show. Joining us now is Brendan Sutton. He's host of The Discourse.
I am the host of The Discourse.
The Discourse.
The Discourse.
You are The Discourse. You are bringing The Discourse, sir.
It's a great name.
It is a great name. Thank you for, and I like, does it still have the graphic where it's like somebody telling like a liberal to go fuck themselves or something, and it's, you like, know, The Discourse?
Yeah, it does.
I was always a big fan of that.
I was going to replace it, but I was like, I really like it.
No, it's funny.
And I mean, it could also.
It always makes me laugh when I see it pop up in my feed.
It could also be, you know, if you're, you know, a inclined libertarian, so, you know.
Right. No, it works. I think I have a similar take on discourse that you do. Which is like, fuck you. Here's my discourse. Shut up.
It's like a...
Yeah, yeah. My discourse is stop discoursing, please. I'm not interested. Speaking of discourse, I don't remember who it was with. I think it was with Felix. Yeah. But we did a segment a couple months ago where it was gulag or re-education. And, you know, the premise was we did a couple of rounds where it was like, you know, this person's either sentenced to eternity in Siberia or maybe there's a possibility they could get out. Megan McArdle was one of the contestants. And if I recall correctly, she was a very early, like, she just needs to go to the gulag because this is, how could somebody, the thing that's striking about her, and I just want to set this preamble, how could somebody be, usually really, really evil monsters, you know, like a Pablo Escobar as an example, even an Ayn Rand, have a certain sort of grotesque or perverse charisma or something that makes them interesting. How Megan McArdle could be as utterly evil as she is and as utterly boring and charisma-free, it's almost like she's like a computer prototype that Peter Thiel is building to like genocide all of us. And I thought after we did this segment that I almost thought, like, you know, most people watching probably don't even know who she is. She's going to go away. She's fun to make fun of. She's the sprinkler lady, whatever. And then she gets hired by the fucking Washington Post because, of course, those people do.
Of course. I mean, I think that the op-ed section at most prestige outlets, you know, ironically serve as an affirmative action place for the most mediocre conservative writers that they could possibly find. And I don't mean affirmative action like, you know, the reality of affirmative action, but I mean like the stereotype of affirmative action that conservatives I believe in. It's surprising. I can't pretend like I have any sort of unique insight into the history or timbre of Megan McArdle insofar as her charisma, but like she has a lot of bangers. When it comes to writing, she has
a
lot of bangers.
Watch her talk for 2 seconds and read one of her columns. It doesn't require that much research. I mean, she is, well, but I like that. I like that image that like Megan, like the conservative image is like, yo, I didn't take any classes in high school. I'm ready to go to Haverford now, man. Like that's their image of affirmative action. And so that actually is happening. Like just like, hey, I'm completely incapable of making an argument and have no data to back up anything I'm saying. I'll take my Washington Post gig now. And they're just like, well, that seems like a counterintuitive take that we don't really know whether children want to starve to death or not until it's measured by science.
Yeah, I don't understand. So I will say this. The piece that I...
Well, you want to get to the piece?
No, I mean, we can get to the piece because, I mean, that's my intro into Megan McArdle. That's the first thing I've ever read that she's done.
How have you avoided Megan McArdle for this? You've been in politics for a couple years.
I know, right?
And you're also just like a generally like a reader. How did you avoid her?
Because
I say this out of envy, by the way.
Because I read good things. I read things that challenge my mind in good ways. Now, I mean, I don't mean that to be disrespectful because I'll be honest. I don't like making fun of people for writing because that is her job. She's a writer. That's what she gets paid to do. It's how she pays her bills. Quality-wise, I don't think she's a very good one. And that's not even speaking to prose. That's speaking to argumentation.
Very safe. Well, okay. You are also, in addition to being a host and a trainer, you are an academic. So let's, and this is a little unfair, frankly, but you did allude to that. So let's take apart, you're going to take us through this. This latest column that received a lot of attention is repealing the Second Amendment would be incredibly difficult. I just want to say, title-wise, pretty on the money.
Yeah.
That is a pretty good observation of reality. But you come at this from the perspective, so You're grading her paper. She's in your class. She's handed this in. Take us through it, Professor Sutton.
Well, so I actually, I don't believe in grades. I believe in feedback.
All right, put on. Okay.
I believe in giving feedback.
All right,
feedback.
For God's sake, take off your fucking hippie shit and give her a grade.
Okay.
Okay, give her feedback.
I believe Jesus in feedback. Christ. So, I started this project on a Discourse Patreon and on, semi-blog type thing that I'm calling the Blue Book, where I take columns by prominent overpaid op-ed writers,
yes,
whether it be your Brett Stevens or your Richard Cohens or your Megan McArdle.
This is great. And everybody should check this out.
And I print them out and format them like high school or college essays, and I just mark them up for basic. I don't grade for grammar, because I think grammar can be in some ways an elitist tool of the bourgeoisie.
I couldn't agree more on that one.
Michael
one is absolutely absolutely true. There's no doubt about that.
But, I just grade for basic, argument. Is this a straw man? Is it a logical fallacy? Where's your evidence? Are you sourcing this? Where does this come from?
So basically, this is just completely unfair to Barry Weiss and Brett Stevens and Megan McArdle. You're actually subjecting them to analysis, which is a pretty tough road. So can you lead us through? I mean, I don't know if you have it in front of you, but I want to really mark this Megan McArdle up, because I enjoy do you want a copy of it?
Yeah, sure. That'd be perfect. So I know what I'm talking about.
Can someone hand it? Oh, I thought this was the one that you did.
I've read a few of them. That was the first.
All right, this is great. Hand this to Brendan. I've read some of these that you've done. They're really good.
Thank you.
This is repealing, and maybe somebody else could print out another one for me, but this is repealing the Second Amendment would be incredibly difficult, which, as I say, so far so good.
Okay, so should I just read it out loud?
I think let's work through the first several why don't you read like the first couple of paragraphs and then start, and we'll see how far we get through it. But just take us through your process as an academic.
This is a real Bataan death march you got me going on this one.
Yes, I do. Okay. I need to take advantage of your mind, Brendan.
There's something simple we could do to stop mass shootings. Ban all guns. Unlike most of the sensible gun control measures in like air quotes, I guess that means that they're not sensible. This would have the virtue of actually preventing mass shootings. The evidence suggests that other, more moderate proposals, again, moderate, scare quotes,
right,
proposals you normally see bruited about, such as enhanced background checks or banning assault weapons, would have very little impact on these massacres. Somewhere in the back of their minds, gun controllers must know a total ban has to be the goal if you really want to stop mass shootings. The firepower needed to kill an elk is greater than what is needed to kill a human. Start leaving exceptions for hunters or sportsmen or some other politically palatable category, and you've left a wide opening for mass shooters to get their hands on deadly firepower. Which is perhaps why Australia's mass gun ban and buyback has become such a popular talking point for those supporting stricter gun control. So I haven't read this piece yet,
yep,
but this already sounds like that piece, that real banger she wrote in 2012 after Sandy Hook. Which again, I will say that was a real high T move. Like after a bunch of kids get shot up to write
Well, did you read her Grenfell Tower take?
I have not read that one.
That was also that. I think a public housing building which caught on fire and caused death in a way that was so horrific that it became global news. And actually, I think my read, and this is speculative, but I actually think that was a not at all insignificant factor in how well Jeremy Corbyn performed in his position now. Like that was a distillation of the horrors of our age. And to have your response to that be like, because this is where she is pretty like galaxy brain, because it isn't like the typical conservative, like even to flip it like, well, this is why we need to privatize it because the private industry will take care of this, or even hey, our bad, this doesn't say anything bigger, but this is our bad, that building should have been properly, to write like basically a speculative piece on how like actually putting sprinklers in might end up causing more deaths through like essentially the logic by which the time you got to the end of it, it could be like, when you really think about it, if you get out of bed in the morning, you could die. So probably shouldn't get up. That was like her take. So Megan has no problem coming in the middle of like the aftermath of a sort of globally agreed upon human horror and or tragedy and just being like, well, actually. And then her well actually is not like a pedantic point. It's usually the most horrific, immoral like argumentation imaginable. So, yeah,
I mean, death is inevitable. So really, why should we try to prevent it at all? Why should we do anything? And I think,
right.
You know, what you've laid out is from what the few pieces of hers that I've read seems typical of her writing style. That's why I said, you know, after reading this first three paragraphs, I can see where she's going with
it. So you're seeing the pattern. All right, well, let's keep going. I love this. I love this. Okay, this is the blue book on TMBS.
Exactly. I like the title, although, you know, with my sort of weird speech habits, it's hard to say it too fast. Like, the blue book.
The blue book, TMBS.
Yeah.
The blue book. I failed right there.
The problem for gun control is that, you know, ban guns is not particularly popular in the United States. Okay, sure. I mean, just say it.
Well, also true.
I guess. I mean,
she's really, actually, she's setting the deck with a lot of truisms so far.
She is. Yeah. I mean,
okay.
Although I will say that her title seems to go against her first sentence. I know repealing the Second Amendment would be incredibly difficult, but then it says there's something simple we could do. That's just a little bit. I mean,
wait, no, I keep reading that out fully. That is really funny.
It's just like, okay, so the title is repealing the Second Amendment would be incredibly difficult. And then, you know, by Megan McArdle, March 28th, like, there's something simple we could do to stop mass shootings, ban all guns.
Right. So seems a little contradictory
I'm
there.
I'm confused.
Yeah. I mean,
I don't get
arguably,
it. What are you trying to say?
I mean, arguably, you can say that it would be quote unquote simple, but, you know, hard as opposed to difficult, you know, real pedantic shit.
Yeah.
If there's one thing libertarians love, it's pedantry.
Yeah, I was going to say that's like their whole, they would literally sacrifice children to the altar of pedantry. So I don't think we're nailing them in anything there.
Actually, it's hebophilia, please.
Yeah.
you misunderstood.
Okay, all right, let's keep going, Professor.
The problem for gun controllers is that banned guns is not particularly popular in the United States. Worse, it has been deemed unconstitutional by the Supreme Court. No amount of verbal gymnastics is going to get the current court to read the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. I'm sorry. What's
oh, I'm sorry. Did it print?
And no, infringed out of the Second Amendment, which leaves only one open path. Repeal the Second Amendment. Okay. So we're getting into meat of it now.
Now it's happening. Now it's popping.
She does that a lot too. Like when she just writes for a long time before getting to the point. This could have been.
She doesn't like bury the lead. She's just sort of like the lead is just going to be far away for some reason. She like if she was opening like a coffee shop, she'd just be like, no, it's not going to be on Main Street. Why? It's just going to be over there. Just going to be an unnecessary long walk.
Okay.
Yeah.
Which is exactly what retired Supreme Court Justice John Paul Stevens proposed this week in an op-ed for the New York Times, to the predictable cheers from the left and jeers from the right. Neither side, however, addressed the obvious omission in the short op-ed. How exactly do we bell that cat? Not easily, that's for sure. She really loves obscure proverbs, too.
What was that phrase? Bell that cat?
I like how she cites bell that cat, but doesn't cite the problem for gun controllers is that banned guns is not particularly popular in the United States. You could just cite that. I mean, you could just add like a little citation like, hey, you know, like here's some statistics for that. I'm sure. I mean, I don't think that she's wrong. It's probably not.
No, I'm sure it's not popular, but better to do. Well, I mean, who wants to do more Google searches?
You could probably, it's probably on the Washington Post. I just want to say that. You know, you could link to your own
who
site.
Who wants to do more Washington Post searches?
Who wants to read more Washington Post
articles? Yeah, actually, that might be her strongest point.
There are two ways to amend the Constitution. The first, a new constitutional convention, is both unlikely and dangerous. Unlikely because you need a two-thirds majority of state legislators to vote to call one. And dangerous because there's no procedure in the Constitution for limiting the convention to a narrow set of issues or procedures. Once called, the convention can make its own rules and do whatever it wants. So liberals, happily contemplating the end of the Second Amendment, might look up to find the convention was getting busy gutting the Fourth and the Fifth Amendments instead.
Oh, well, I think that's actually true.
Yeah, that is true.
I think that's actually a good point.
That's a very good point.
That sounds like a warning to liberals. Okay, fair enough.
I will say, you know, got to give the devil their due.
Yep.
A lot of her pieces have like good points in them,
right,
that could be expanded upon and really examined. Like here if we go down this path, this is a very good argument. Yeah, you know, we could sort of explore the whole way through. I doubt that she will. I'm just saying.
That's your prediction halfway through as a professional, that she will not elaborate on the good points. All right, well, let's see whether you're right or not, Professor.
What about the second path? Well, first you would need two-thirds majorities of both the House and Senate to pass a proposed amendment. Then you would need to get three-quarters of all the state legislators to ratify. This means convincing a majority of voters in a supermajority of the country's legislative districts to support politicians who support the repeal. If you haven't looked too deeply into the politics, that probably sounds easier than it actually is. Doesn't really sound that easy, to be honest.
No, that's, yeah.
Don't majorities of people say they favor gun control?
Yeah.
Ask with most questions about polling. The answer is yes, but how you word poll questions matters a lot. Oh, here we go. Here we go.
Okay, great.
Okay. Matters a lot. Vague phrases such as tighter gun control or fine-sounding but not very effective measures such as stronger background checks are going to poll better than ban all guns. Repeal the Second Amendment currently polls at about 20%.
Let's see.
We should put on some music.
Yeah, put on some funk. I don't know.
We're gonna put on some.
Okay, perfect.
Okay.
The prospects for repeal are even worse than the numbers suggest.
If you read all Megan McArdle out loud to this music, it might be tolerable.
Yeah, that's a nice little bass to it. It's fine. Since political offices are apportioned geographically, it doesn't do any good to have 90% majorities supporting something in a handful of high population cities while the rest of the country stands opposed. Not only would repeal supporters need to find a lot of voters in the right places, they would also need those voters to be highly motivated. Gun owners may be a minority of the population, but they really care about their right to own guns. If a politician threatens to take their guns away, they will make sure they get to the polling place come November to vote against that politician, even if they support his other policies. Okay,
so I'm exhausted by how obvious this all is. I'm guessing this is leading up to some disingenuous payoff.
It's very banal, but, you know, honestly, yes. As we go up to it, really, the context of this whole piece is that we can't do anything.
Right.
Like, I think we all agree that the context
of the
piece.
That is always the point. And like nothing to be done. And if we did, it might have some mysterious side consequence.
Support for gun control is broader, but it's also weaker. Since shootings are fairly uncommon, when we actually go to the ballot box, gun control tends to rank well below things that more directly affect our daily lives, such as taxes, schools, and the quality of government services. You know, okay, sure. I mean, all I can say, like,
have you ever written that in a student's paper, by the way?
No,
I haven't. Next to a graph, have you written, okay, sure?
No, I mean, like, I honestly, when she says things like this, I flash back to the whole Belle the Cat thing, and all the time it probably took her to, like, the Google search that, and I would just love to see, like, some numbers in this. And I know, and maybe that makes me weird, because I don't read a lot of op-eds.
No, I agree.
I just, like, okay, just, if it, and that's the thing, too, some of this stuff is true, but she still refuses to source, so she's not being disingenuous. Like Ben Shapiro, when he's lying, he doesn't source right. things, because he's being intellectually
He's just dishonest. Like, everybody knows that.
A lot of things,
yeah,
just,
that's
like,
his
lazy.
Move, right.
Like, lazy, banal, like, lazy, right. banal, like, this truisms.
Yes.
Okay. When one side of an issue is willing to tell pollsters they support something, and the other side of the issue is willing to act on their belief, the side that acts tends to win, even if they are numerically smaller. This fundamental electoral math explains a lot of seeming anomalies in American politics, including the gap between gun polls and gun policy. Does it really, though? I mean, okay, sure, whatever. This is just like an opinion, man. Whatever. In recent days...
This is all sky is blue, not supported by data and opinions. This is all... To the extent it's true, it's obvious.
I mean, in the sense that it's true, it comes across as incredibly, as the musing rants of somebody who was just like, I was asked to write a piece about, you know, pro or in favor of gun control, and they wrote it that morning.
Right, right.
But
a boring student's blog.
A boring student's blog, or, you know. Yeah. We're almost done, though. We're almost done.
Yes.
In recent days, there has been some suggestions that this is changing, that gun controllers are getting just as intense about this issue as their opponents. Perhaps, but 6 months from now... Really? Okay. I'm sorry. I mean, I'm not commenting.
But 6 months from now,
I'm not going to comment on that. When the Parkland, Florida shooting is out of the news, gun owners will still own their guns, and they will still care intensely about keeping them. The people currently telling pollsters they will vote on the gun issue may still feel that way, but they may also have moved on to some other issue that is fresher in their minds or closer to their daily lives. Okay, sure. They may have also moved on, or maybe they won't have. I don't, like who knows, really?
Like, yeah. Actually, I really hate to put this out there, or it's like, or maybe there'll be another dozen absolutely terrifying public shootings, and it will stay prominent in the news cycle. Or maybe all gun violence will stop and will be transported out of our bodies into the astral plane.
Really?
Like, I mean, what is that? Like, yeah, maybe a lot of shit. All right, let me read the last graph because I want the full grade, and then we got to get to Ben Shapiro. The good news for gun controllers is that I'm probably being too conspiratorial here, but the good news for gun controllers is that school shootings and mass shootings in general are, in fact, pretty rare. And not rare enough, unfortunately, but too rare to feel like a personal issue to most voters most of the time. The bad news is that it makes it very difficult to get critical political mass you need to make them even rarer. So she's sort of indirectly saying, you know, what I was saying, which is like, hey, you want gun control, you should be looking for a lot of more absolutely horrible shit to happen. But I guess my concern, and let me just play your TA here for a second. I feel as if she made a claim, she answered it, but with no data, but she's probably right, but again, no data. And then in this case, this is interesting because I feel like this means Megan must think that she's on her back heels on this, because the more like confident version of Megan McArdle is like, everybody thinks that poor kids should get inhalers, but here's why it will actually lead to an obesity epidemic, right? Like, that's her usual play. This one's just kind of like, she's almost saying like, she's playing like, I don't have any dog in this fight. I'm just telling you the way of the world. And of course, the subtext is the same libertarian bullshit she always does, which is that never use collective action to solve anything and just deal with kids getting shredded to death with bullets in their schools, not to mention structural American violence, which disproportionately affects people of color and poor people, which obviously, if that's not even a liberal conversation, it's certainly not going to be in Megan's conversation.
Well, of course. And I think that she has a few, you know, again, this is probably my fourth article by her, but I think she has a few key moves that as you notice across all her articles. One of them is this sort of appeal to the fact that complex problems have complex solutions. And in having complex solutions, right? You know, so like in having complex solutions, like, hey, well, maybe we do need to ban assault rifles, limit their availability. And so therefore, it won't be as easy to get them. So yeah, it won't stop all mass shootings. Of course it won't, because obviously some mass shootings happen without assault rifles, you know, which again is not a real category of weapon. So since it wouldn't stop all of them, let's not do it. Let's not do anything.
Right.
Let's not do anything. I like how she brings up the
I just want to add something else here. A lot of answers to complex problems are actually very simple.
Yeah.
Like complex financial instruments, here's a simple answer, ban them. Wall Street melted down the economy. Nationalize the banks, and you will find yourself, we're going to start doing some new potentially new segments about this, but I remember one time I was debating a Wall Street guy, and it was really awkward because it was like at a gym and we were like literally like running on treadmills, and this, and I had no desire to have any of this, but he was like one of these guys who just kept yakking. And he's doing this whole like, yeah, but you know, a lot of you guys, you don't understand, like there's leverage. And he started throwing started doing the game of like, there's all this special esoteric language that lay people don't understand, and it's so complicated. And I was like, and he said all this shit, and I was like, dude, look, I don't have an MBA, but I saw Goodfellas. Everything you just said there is the restaurant scene where they burn it down to get the insurance after jacking up the credit cards on the owner. Why shouldn't that be regulated? And he literally was like, no, I guess you have a point. So people will come at you. This is a tactic of both neoliberals and the right. And ironically, not only do a lot of complex answers, policies don't need complex solutions, it's ironically a substitute. Like it's when people start saying it requires complex answers, they're actually cueing you into stupid thinking.
Oh, yeah. And I agree. Yeah. And I think that you're right when it's become a tool of neoliberalism to you know, use complexity as shorthand for intelligence, or yes, if, you know, to attach some, to ascribe some sort of morality to complexity or intelligence that doesn't necessarily agree. The
cult of smartness.
Yeah, the cult of smartness, the cult of logic, the cult of rationality. Yep. Like the more complex
all
and technocratic.
Bullshit.
And technocrats, the solution is, the better it is inherently.
Yep.
When, you know, look at the conversation surrounding Medicare for All. It's like the easiest thing to do is cover everybody, get rid of all the bureaucracy, cut through all the red tape. But that's not complex enough. That doesn't have enough fucking Excel spreadsheets. Doesn't have enough sort of means testing. And the obvious thing is that complexity is A, not always better, and B, very hard to sell to people. And, you know, a simple solution will do, but.
No doubt. All right. What are the other three things that we've learned about Megan?
Oh, yeah. The other three things that she... So a good example of this is when you go to the idea of like, well, polling doesn't always give you correct answers. Like sometimes, right, depending on the question that you ask, it changes the... That's absolutely true. Survey questions, like this is something they teach you when they're teaching you how to design surveys. Asking a question the right way in a survey is really an art form. And sometimes people like purposely fudge it up to portray things in a way that make the, you know... For example, if you ask people if they want Medicare for All, it does better than, say, universal health care or socialized medicine. Great example of that. Branding matters, blah, 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 blah,
yep,
blah.
Yep.
That's not really an argument against doing it, though. You know, like that, like this idea that some sort of volatility in like survey answers, it like proves that they're untrustworthy, or that, you know, you just can't trust. I don't know where this comes from. And I do, though. Right. So I think that Megan is a great example of, or maybe the only example I've ever seen, of like this vulgar postmodernism that the conservatives always accuse like liberals and leftists of.
Right.
Where she just appeals to this idea, well, really, there's never going to be consensus on anything. You can never really know anything, right? You know, like there's all these opinions out there, you know, like really, you know,
we're all just creating our own master narratives. Yeah, it's true.
It's really true. And so really all we can hope to do is maintain the status quo,
right,
prevent society from devolving into chaos. Right. But there's no point actually trying to solve anything.
So that's interesting, because because on the other hand, in the, you know, logic and rationality world, that's, polls are used in two ways. They're either used with zero critical awareness. If they're telling you what you want, Muslims are X, then we don't have any methodology to question. We don't have any subtlety to explore. Or in Megan's case, it's, you know, hey man, polls are fucked up. So bottom line, don't do anything about guns.
Yeah, I mean, she's appealing to nuance to like obscure the point.
Yeah.
I think that's like what you're trying to say, right? Like,
yeah, you know,
when we talk about, let's say, the black on black crime rate, for lack of a better term, like the rate at which black people commit crimes that affect other black people. It's like the context of that is always stripped out, because it's always just like, well, we got to focus on the numbers. And it's like, okay, well, what do those numbers mean? Like, what criminologist or sociologist or demographer or geographer are you talking to that is going to say that this is inherent? This is sort of these numbers are inherent, are a commentary on the inherent qualities of blackness or black people or whatever population of black people you're talking about. Like, none. But we want to focus on numbers. But in the case
I'm making the distinction, right? That's the first part, and that's what you get from the, you know, the Harris world.
Yeah.
And that's what you're addressing there. And then Megan's doing the opposite, yeah, which is like, why even measure any stats related to people who might be poor, as an example? Because, you know, you can't really trust stats. So just let people, we don't even know if they don't want to starve to death. So just let it happen.
Yeah, but I mean, but you see that too, yeah, with Brett Stevens, right? Brett Stevens is the one who hates climate science, right? He's a climate science denier, right?
Oh, yeah.
And like, and what he does is sort of related to this. Like, you know, he applies to the volatility of statistics,
yep,
to sort of obscure the point about how bad climate change actually is. Well, he says, well, you know, climate scientists are lying to you. They're saying that they can tell you with certainty that the ocean temperatures are going to rise by, you know, 2 degrees centigrade, but they can't tell you that because it might rise by 4 degrees centigrade, or it might rise by one, or it may decrease by one,
right?
Because like all of these sort of, you know, outcomes are possible within this system. Now, what he doesn't tell you is that the likelihood of those outcomes, and B, that the difference between 1 degree rise centigrade and say 4 is like all life on Earth.
Right.
And so like,
yeah, exactly.
And so when, you know, when you compare that to the volatility that you see in something like, you know, who's going to win the election, Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton, like, okay, well, that's a binary choice. Like only one or the other can happen. So at certain point, it's just like,
yeah,
who cares? But when it comes to something like that, where there are so many outcomes and so many, like there's such a distribution of effects, it's hard to justify that kind of mentality.
Well, he's giving you, that's another good thing to be aware of when you're talking to these people, because he's, that's basically that original Bret Stephens, and I don't remember whether I said this or not at the time, but his original, his climate column that he published when he, one of his first columns when he got hired at the Times to give these brilliant counterintuitive opinions, was a, it was a sophisticated seeming dressed up version of a talk show host going, global warming's cold outside. Like, that was the column, just with science words and probably like a Nassim Taleb reference about black swans or some bullshit. But the same basic scientists can't tell you with total certainty, right? With obscuring everything you just contextualize. And then like, you know, by the way, what about, you know, good old-fashioned common sense?
Yeah, I mean, the genius thing about that climate column was how he portrayed the ambiguity as a way that could only vindicate the sort of lukewarmers, I think they're called.
Yes.
Like, it's not so bad, but right, it actually could be. Right?
No, it
like,
could actually vindicate that this is going to happen faster than the consensus.
And we're fucked.
And we're utterly fucked no matter what we do, which isn't a useful framework to have because we should do something. But I'm saying, like, there's no... I mean, that's actually, you know, that's... I don't want to dredge this up again, but it's, like, analogous to that moment with Harris and Klein where it was, like... No, Flynn said that the 12, like there could be a 12 point differential of environmental and genetic. That is possible if we're taking all the science seriously. And then it goes back to like, yeah, but we're talking about saying serious things where it's like, oh, well, you just showed your cards there, buddy. Because if you really were just in the pure ambiguity, but also narrow reading of the numbers, then that's a totally viable possibility. All right, what's the third thing about Megan
McArdle?
The
third thing is, that, and this is something that I've seen through a lot of the conservative columns I read, like there's a certain egocentrism that runs through these pieces that borders on, I don't know, solipsistic.
Oh, yeah.
Insofar
I don't
that,
know if it borders.
Like, no, like, yeah, insofar that it's just like, I make fun of the lack of sources, even when it does, you know, even when she's saying things that are true, provable, right, like factual statements, you right know, more or less, right? You know, obviously there's some debate about the context of them. But it all seems to be predicated on this sort of insistence that, you know, whatever knowledge they have or they feel that they have, it constitutes either modern thought or the consensus or even what you, I guess you'd consider, you know, a meaningful dissenting voice, right? So the piece that I did with her that I, you know, that I did, which inspired this sort of, I guess you'd call it this project, was the one about, you know, what caused the riots in 1968. And that was...
It must have been a banger.
And it was a banger. It was a real banger. And her, you know, her...
What I can't even guess this one. Go
her
ahead.
Thesis was respect.
Oh,
she
yeah
said respect. You know, and I'll be honest with you, when I read that, I thought she was going to say, well, black people just don't respect property enough. You know, they don't respect the state and, right, you know, and you know, the meaningful institutions that we have for sort of redressing our grievances.
Right.
But it was more banal than that, right? It was really just like this lukewarm argument that while apparently the most, I guess, the dominant ideology for discussing social issues in America is Marxism.
Whoa. From your lips to Allah's ears,
exactly,
lady.
From Megan McArdle, yeah, from Megan McArdle's, you know, pin to yeah, like to, you know, the God's ears with that
yeah
one.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
In truth, it's,
we're working on it, but fuck, I don't know. I mean, shit.
In truth, you know, it yeah was respect that caused it, and you know, right, like, and we, and essentially,
well, wait, respect that like people didn't feel respected, so they rioted. Or see, what is it? I don't even know what that means. It's
see,
too amorphous.
Me either. Still, and I've read the piece, and that's one of the issues, right? So, a lot of what this is with her writing is that she doesn't bother to, you know, frame it properly or even really define her terms. So when I went
not
into respect, when I saw respect, I was like, okay, what she's trying to say is that she's forming this classic dichotomy between misrepresentation of image and like maldistribution of resources as like the two dominant forms of oppression and prejudice right that you can experience. Either you don't have enough shit or people are, you know, or people are misrepresenting you. Class, you know, classic dichotomy, obviously there's overlap, but you can make that argument. No, she was just saying that respect is a thing that exists that people want. And it can, you can look at it like social respect, but also respect is, you know, a lack of resources. You know, respect is not getting that job you want. So really respect is everything. You know, respect, there is no problem.
Money, power, respect, man.
Exactly.
It's the key to
right
life. Maybe Megan McArdle, I mean, just listen to Bad Boy records instead.
You know, like, why do anything?
Whatever was relevant from that point was covered much better. Who did that one? Was that the Lox? Who did that one?
Ooh, which one? Money Power
Respect. Money Power Respect. Lil Kim? I don't even remember who did that one. Was Junior Mafia?
There were the remix too.
Can we put on that for the, as we can get to the fourth point, let's have a little Money Power Respect in the background. Because it is the key to life. And I actually wonder if Megan McArdle ever even heard that track.
I guess the four points is one that we've been talking about the entire time. It's like, it's this nihilism that runs through her pieces. And that runs through a lot of these pieces where it's just like, there's nothing you can do. Like, there's nothing we can do for X, so why even try? And, of course, that's related to the fact that, you know, there's nothing that we can do to entirely solve X.
Who is this? Hold on one sec. Oh, it's Lil' Kim. Oh, it's the Lox. I called
right.
it. Yeah, see? I had us do proper research. I didn't just say something like the Lox. That would be the Megan McArdle technique.
Perhaps
that was a dope song.
Wrapped it with the lock. But yeah, there's a strain of unhelpful nihilism that runs through all her pieces that really is weird because, you know, it's something that, again, this is something that you, like, the, that I guess you say liberals can accuse leftists of a lot. Like, leftists is a leftist critique that we get, a critique we get as leftists where, oh, we always damn the good for the perfect. You
right.
know, we don't want, you know, we don't want Hillary because Bernie is sort of, you know, is the reincarnation of now.
Right. reincarnation. on my show, he is.
Yeah. but, you know, she's really the only one I've seen who does this, which is like, okay, well, we know the only way to stop all gun violence is to ban guns. And so, therefore, you know what? Well, I guess we can't stop it. So we, why even try?
But there's a weird distinction here. So I think sometimes that actually, yes, I do think. I think that real actual socialist leftists need to get better about claiming victories and opening the pressure points and there needs to be more strategic thinking about that. But here's the key distinction. When people on the left are talking about getting, first of all, they're serious about getting where we need to go. And they might be attacking halfway measures because that's not going to do the job. What she's doing is she's actually saying, and libertarians do this a lot. This is a very specific libertarian thing. They'll paint a world. They'll say, like, I want world peace, or I want, you know, no one to be compelled to do anything they don't want to do, whether by, I mean, certainly by government, but sometimes they'll even try to pretend by corporations or the private sector, even though that's literally their whole, they're literally advocating for neo-feudal rule. But whatever, setting that aside, and they'll come with a million crazy nerd scenarios that, like, well, if you deregulate this and then da, 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 and then people can choose and then all the water will be clean and everything will magically work out. And even before you get, and obviously it's all fantasy and nonsense, but even before you get to that, the one major distinction is that the process by which we're getting or attempting to get to those end goals actually moves us towards them. They do this incredibly cynical two-step where it's like, well, I want this great thing, and I'm actually going to work with every single fiber of my being to contradict getting there while claiming that either I want to get there or, like McArdle's doing here, which is not really claiming anything, just saying something that actually is true, not coming down on one side or another with it, and then just actually it circles in the end to, we're not even going to do background checks, which is the whole point of this article.
Wait, I mean,
which is actually pretty funny.
Yeah, of course. I mean, well, this is what contextualizes the article. Yeah. The article is contextualized by just the conversation we're having, which is that, okay, we should do more background checks.
Right.
You know, we should do more when it comes to making sure domestic violence, people with domestic violence records that don't have, you know, don't have access to guns. Because that's the thing too, right? So she puts moderate gun reforms in scare quotes. But she doesn't really list any of them because they're things that we generally agree upon. Like, you know, people who have domestic violence records probably should not have access to firearms just based on the stats that tell us that they're more likely to, you know, that's a good indicator for school shoot for mass shootings.
Yep.
That's a good indicator for, like, not only mass shootings, but, you know, killing
spouse,
your wife with guns,
killing
and spousal
your wife.
Abuse, like all of these things. Right. And so, like, that's this piece doesn't exist in a vacuum.
Right.
This piece exists as a way to subvert and muddy the conversation about doing anything. And so, I mean, I agree with you when it comes to leftists, right? I think that there is something to be said when across the board about not agreeing to sort of short-term solutions that are, you know, there's an old saying, right? Like, if it takes, 50 newtons of force to move a boulder and you're only going to push 40 newtons, it doesn't make a difference. Like, right. It's not going to move. It's not going to help you, like, move it. So, like, at a certain point, we have to, like, set up a standard for what's the minimum we can do that's going to move us in the right direction without obscuring the, you know, the point. But in this case, like, it only exists to obscure the point. The conversation around gun reform.
All right. Let's touch on, and we can, I like how we should keep playing this great track while we set up the last piece of business we have to do before we get to the post game. And that is deal with little Mr. Spiffy shirt, facts don't care about your feelings himself. And
Ben Shapiro?
Yeah. I'm setting this up.
Did you know we have like the exact same stats apparently? Like he claims that he's like 5'9" and like a heavy lifter. And I'm like, oh my God, me too.
I do not believe him.
I mean, like,
I'm going to need to have some real independent statistical analysis for that.
If Ben Shapiro can outlift me, I'm spending basically every day in the gym.
Yeah, if Ben Shapiro can outlift me, I will look like you in a year.
Just like
I will spend 5 hours lifting and doing roids.
Just tweet him like stats, bro. which is like 5'9". Yeah. Like
facts don't care about your. Did you say 2'10"?
5'9", 2'10".
No, I thought you said Ben Shapiro's 2'10".
That's what he's saying, right? He's out there like he's 5'9", 2'10", like 5% body fat.
okay.
Don't fact check me on that one.
We're gonna need to dig into that. People send us for the post game. If what you are saying turns out to be true, we have a much bigger problem in our hands with that little guy. All right. I'm going to just quote from Charlie Pierce, who wrote this up in Esquire. We're exporting the worst of our political waste to Canada. Now, last year, there was a mass shooting in Quebec City, and it was religiously, racially motivated. It was at a mosque. Alexandre Bessent, I know I'm butchering this, killed 6 people and wounded 19 others as part in a murder spree at a mosque. It was an anti-Muslim hate crime. I'm going to quote now. He's about to go on trial for this. As part of the evidence against him, who apparently knew full well what he was doing and is an accomplished bullshit artist besides, the prosecutors entered a list of the Twitter feeds that Bissonnette visited while he was ramping himself up on mass murder. And Riga of the Montreal Gazette reports on the unsurprising details. Now, the top person in this Twitter feed, and as you can imagine, I'll go through some of the names, you know, Owen Schroyer from InfoWars, Tucker Carlson, Paul Joseph Watson, Ann Coulter, Mike Cernovich, Alex Jones, Kellyanne Conway, David Duke, Laura Ingraham, Gavin McGinnis, Breitbart, Stefan Molyneux, you know, all you know, the worst people on the planet. And what
Ben Domenech, I just want to flag Ben Domenech, the plagiarist from the Federalist.
The plagiarist from the Federalist. All right. I mean, we have this up here on screen. But what's really interesting is that the top person that he searched for is Ben Shapiro. Now, that's interesting because Ben Shapiro is very committed to distinguishing his brand from every other person on the list. While at the same time, Ben Shapiro's writing and comments on Palestinians, Arabs, and Muslims could go toe-to-toe, pound for pound, and actually probably even exceed many other members of this list.
What I think is interesting, you know, just a point of comparison right here, is that the number of times he visited Ben Shapiro's Twitter account, I assume, is exactly how tall Ben Shapiro is in centimeters. And so, I just think that kismet.
Kismet.
Let's keep going. Sorry.
So so the basic breakdown here is: look, first, I think you know I say always I think hypocrisy points are boring, but if you know some left person, you know, I mean, they tried to pin the guy who shot Steve Scalise on Bernie.
You're damn right.
You're goddamn right. I wish the prick friggin' aimed better. I could see he's not even, he's still wheeling around, for God's sake. It's pathetic.
He's not a Bernie marksman.
He's not a, for effort is not going to cut it.
He's
going to
go down.
As Brendan Sutton said, if we don't have enough people to actually move the boulder, it makes no difference. And that's what I would like to apply to Steven Scalise. But no, I mean, in all seriousness, although I could do that routine all night, I mean, First, it's that, you know, the reason it's ridiculous to pin that on Bernie is because there is nobody on any type of left platform, including like those of us that, you know, that fuck around more and are satiric and way more polemical and all of this stuff. We don't. And I mean, maybe I wish we, unfortunately, I mean, we have the screenshot where, you know, and I don't happen to support these laws, but, you know, Ben Shapiro's tweets have been banned under hate crimes legislation in France and Germany. Maybe we could call some of these up. Unfortunately, I should have gotten them. But I mean, we are not talking about categories of people, let alone any ethnic category, religious category of people, as being like agents of darkness or subhuman or, you know, not of the light, or that, okay, this is a Ben Shapiro. Israelis like to build, Arabs like to bomb crap and live in open sewage. This is not a difficult issue. Settlements rock. This is his aggressive support for Israeli apartheid.
Weird that hashtag never caught on.
Yeah, yeah. So the point is not to say, look, Ben Shapiro did not call for this type of activity. He's not, you know, condoning it. But the notion that he's having a meltdown because people are pointing this out, it is totally logical and coherent that a hate-filled person targeting Muslims would have a lot to enjoy in reading Ben Shapiro.
Also, it's worth pointing out that he has pointed this stuff out in the past, too. Yeah. There is a tweet that exists out there where he asked from, I want to say, 2012, where he asked Piers Morgan if the shooting that if some shooter was a fan of Piers Morgan.
Okay, so there's also some element of, you know, what's good for the goose is good for the gander
here. It is, right? I think that you're right when it comes down to, like, I think hypocrisy points are also boring, mostly right, because the right doesn't care about hypocrisy. And only, like, that sort of liberal, technocratic mind of adults, yep, like, when it's like, ha, but, you know, like, you talk about caring about the debt, but this is not, you know, but, right, like, but you're going to add
more to
it.
And then Republicans are like, dude, I will fucking kill your grandmother in front of you. Like, hypocritical about debt spending? Yeah. Like, really?
Hypocrisy points right, just are just only serve to make liberals feel better about their sort of adulthood and maturity.
That's the West Wing fantasy.
Yeah, it's the West Wing fantasy, right? Right. But there's something to be said, I think, about the ways in which in this situation, on the left, I think that we're better and we should be about nuance, right? About, mm-hmm, talking about the context of things, about parsing things out when it comes to responsibility, you know, likelihood, whether it be structural violence, systemic violence, et cetera, et cetera. But there's something to be said about how nuance in these situations has been weaponized by, eight structures of power against leftist figures, right? You know, right, against people who lack the kind of capital to defend themselves against or demand that they be, that moral complexity or nuance be acknowledged, right? So
no, there's people that even people that I actually happen to disagree with, you know, pretty strongly. I mean, we're talking about Syria earlier, but they've been accused of being, you know, agents of a Russian government. They've been told, you know, that these people are excused mass murder and war crimes. And, you know, smears. Like, I mean, Glenn Greenwald's a clear example. I disagree with Glenn Greenwald on some of his reads of 2016 election. I disagree with him on some of his reads of the Trump investigation, actually pretty thoroughly. But people are, you know, lie about him and frame him with just utter impunity, completely outside the context of his own writing. So there's no doubt that they throw this out all the time themselves. I think the other thing here that's also worth, and I mean, this is a point that a lot of people made, and I want to slightly complexify it. I think on one hand, especially in our, you know, in left and liberal discourse, certainly not in the mainstream discourse, but in the left and liberal discourse, you know, we've had to resurrect these people that have been discredited by the neoliberal agenda, like Adolf Reed, and sort of, you know, complexify some of the identity conversations and have class analysis and recognize that, you know, certainly whether it's the Clinton campaign or, you know, just average crap writers and Twitterers, that people, you know, I mean, for all the things we've talked about a million times, they weaponize identity to forward neoliberal politics. I think it's very important when we go to Ben Shapiro and, you know, look at the things that he said, both in terms of overtly supporting murderous campaigns by Israelis, apartheid policies, you know, that there's still, you know, the New York Times, for all of its unbelievable hypocrisies, blind spots and bullshit, if Ben Shapiro, and Ben Shapiro's, by the way, also said plenty of racist things about black people, but if he said, you know, ending apartheid in South Africa was a mistake. The ANC is terrorists, and South African blacks are better off. They just want to live in sewage and burn white farms. He wouldn't have gotten a profile called Cool Kids Philosopher in the New York Times. That might have actually been a bridge too far. All of that was said about Palestinians and Arabs. And I just think that, you know, it is important, I think, with, and that's the reason why, you know, I hold no brief for Islam as a religion, but in the context of American discourse and policy, that just sustained and relentless dehumanization of them, and that it's not even a controversy in so many quarters, is just relentless.
Oh, no, I agree, right? And I think that this has been a concerted effort for the past, I would, you know, at least as far as I'm thinking, like, since the Iraq war started, since the invasion of Afghanistan started. It goes way back further than that, but I think that now we, like, for the past 16 or so years, two decades or so, there's been a conscious effort to, like, homogenize and dehumanize and the entire Middle East, right? Like, how many people who have strong opinions about Islam and the Islamic world can tell you, you know, what that actually entails, right? Can tell you the difference between, like, Shiite and Sunni. Can tell you the difference between, you know, much less, like, a coherent definition of Wahhabism.
You're bringing back some very traumatic memories of some YouTube spats that I've engaged in.
YouTube is a hellhole. YouTube is like a right-wing hellhole. But you know, except for all of the, you know, the, like, the Let's Players who only occasionally say the N-word.
All right. So, but, I mean,
But yeah, so, I mean, I think that we've done a very poor job, not we, but, you know, our mainstream media, our corporate media, has done a very poor job of allowing, like I said, you know, the complexity of the Middle East to shine through, because we deny that our enemies. We deny complexity and nuance to our enemies because it makes it easier to engage in asymmetric warfare. When you know, when you do things like, the best example I can think of is, like, you know, the criteria for what constitutes a terrorist in our drone program. Like, well, if you happen to be, you know, between the ages of 16 and 35, well, you're a terrorist, and, you know, we'll sort it out afterwards. Like, that's the definition.
No, I just want to be really clear. That's really precise. In signature strikes, they drop bombs, going back to the Obama administration. God knows what they're doing now, because they've unshackled all even modest restrictions on this stuff. If we say we're hanging out, we're Pakistani, we're all guys inside that age range, you know, at a camp somewhere, we could be hunting. Have nothing to do with anything. They would bomb the target based off of behavioral profiling, and then not, like, definitionally, they wouldn't follow up on it because there isn't anything to investigate because you're a predetermined terrorist. Yeah. And that's the policy.
That's the policy. And I think that it was a mistake. You know, if I'm going to pick on Obama for a little bit, it was a mistake when the Bush administration ended and Obama administration came in to believe that just simply changing the tone of the rhetoric and changing our view would actually result in a change in the cultural perception of the Middle East. Yeah. And I think that what Democrats fail to do is establish a coherent counter narrative for a lot of these problematic policies and instead see too much ground to Republicans. And they sort of engage in as well, mealy mouth defense of the military industrial complex, mealy mouth defense of imperialism, you know, because it has to be necessary. And they just assume that if you put the right tone on it, call them terrorists, if you don't sort of, like, you know, call them bad names, that people, you know, Americans, the American culture won't internalize what it means to be engaged in perpetual warfare against them, right?
Well, I think the transition from 24 to Homeland. I mean, 24 is Bush era. They're fucking there. I got to put a screwdriver in his asshole so he talks. And then we go to Homeland and it's all like, I studied Farsi at Swarthmore and I feel so sad about having to put a screwdriver in this guy's ass. Like, it's the same policy, but it's just moralized and complex. But it's just a different brand for empire.
Of course,
I have one question before we go to the post game.
And it just doesn't play right. So I think mostly what it ends up with people just filling in the blanks themselves. Yep. People saying, okay, well, if we're just bombing this place indiscriminately, when they remember that we're bombing it, then there must be something inherently wrong with this place. There must be something inherently wrong.
And the people that come from it.
Yeah. And people come from it, right? They start ascribing characteristics to Islam and the Middle East and homogenizing in a way that justifies that bombing, because there is no real justification that can be provided within liberal doctrine or, you know, it's just like, it's something that we have. I don't know.
Yeah. No, I think that's totally right. Final, we're going to go to the postgame in a minute. Can we leverage this to take a chunk out of Ben Shapiro's brand?
Well, Ben Shapiro, like all, you know, Ben Shapiro, like you said, he does his best to separate himself from the other,
yes.
you know, the alt-right and the alt-light. And that's another good example of how, you know, when these white supremacist people, white whether it be white ethno-nationalists or white supremacist, you know, light or neo-Nazis or Nazis, the media and people in the mainstream still deny that we engage in this sort of pedantic argument about, well, yes. who's, you can't call them exactly. all Nazis. And of course you can't. You know, there's something to be said about nuance there. But, like, we're forced to actually engage in deep, meaningful conversations about the difference between, like, Ben Shapiro and Gary McInnes. Is that his name?
Gavin McInnes.
Gavin McInnes and sort of Mike
The only difference is that actually, and I'm sorry if Gavin sees this, Ben Shapiro is actually genuinely funnier than Gavin McInnes.
Oh,
that's the only distinction that okay. I see. Yeah, but go ahead.
But yeah, we have yeah. to engage in these conversations about nuance, but really ultimately, you know, the implications for all this speech, and this is not me sort of like blaming it on Ben Shapiro. I think that might be a step too far, but the implications for all of this speech and who it might appeal to and the rhetoric and, you know, what it might sort of embolden is the same, right? People right. see through these sort of pull-out arguments that Ben Shapiro or your old friend Sargon of Akkad like to do, where they sort
that
of...
That was
like,
the traumatic memory
yeah.
I had.
Yeah, I love the interview.
Yeah, that was great.
No. Like yeah. people see through that sort of pull-out method of argumentation where you lead the person to your thesis. You go, oh, well, I'm not saying that the Middle East deserves to be bombed indiscriminately. I'm not saying right. that, you know, Islam is the mother of all bad religions. I'm just saying that in the context of all this torture and all this bombing and all these war crimes, that, like, here are some facts about the Middle East that are entirely objective that may change your mind. And right. it's like, and it's just like, but come on, like, I know the game. It's just a coward's way from engaging. I have a little bit more respect for people, like, you know, I hate Muslims. You know, Muslims are bad. I'm glad that we're torturing them. Like, those people,
thank
I don't understand.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Brendan. I appreciate the honesty.
You're not cowards.
I'm not a coward. Ask Ivanka. All right, everybody. We're going to go to the post game. We've got a lot for you. We've got some clips that we have to dunk on. Maybe we have some games. We're going to open the phones, the IMs, the Discord. There's a ton. Brendan, you're going to stay with us.
I am.
The Discourse. Check it out. Check out the Blue Brook. How can they? What's your Patreon address?
My Patreon address is patreon.com/expandthediscourse. The Blue Book, but damn it, fuck it, I messed it up again. The Blue Book blog. I'm sorry, yeah, I cursed a lot.
Just restart. That's totally fine, but restart.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, so check out my Patreon. It's patreon.com/expandthediscourse. It spells like how it sounds. Expand the discourse. And the Blue Book blog is on that Patreon. And every week I do about 2 or 3 breakdowns of popular op-eds of that week, or classic bangers from, like, the Megan McArdle, Brett Stevens, you know, the Morrissey's of the political world.
That's awesome. It's really good. And here, be with us for the post game. Guys, we're growing. That 2K, we're going to announce a specific date that we want to hit that by. New things for people at the 21 level. Thank you so much. Patreon.com/TMBS. Keep spreading the word. Thank you, Matt. Thank you, David. Thank you, David. See you all in the post game. 64657. Find out the rest in the post game. Become a patron. I know. Bye.